Hey everyone, welcome back to DreamSpace TV here in One Microsoft Place in Dublin. This is episode 5, I can't believe that. It's our second last episode. We've lots to cover. We want to keep building on our knowledge of Python and other things as well. So let's see what's ahead of us.
So in today's episode, we're going to recap over our extension challenge from the previous episode. Then we're going to move on and we're going to create a program that encourages us to be active, which links with our third global goal. So Amanda, what's our third global goal again?
Yeah, so our third global goal is good health and well-being, which remember, Niamh, is one of the focus ones for the Do Your Bit challenge as well. So global goal 3.
Exactly, so it's very, very important. And finally, we're going to discuss AI for health.
Brilliant. So I might bring us through the extension challenge from the last episode to begin with. And just a reminder, the extension challenge was to create your own accessible and inclusive game. So the game we had covered was Rock, Paper, Scissors, one we're all very familiar with. And remember what we did was we shook the microbit. I have the code up here on the screen. We shook the microbit as our input. It called on the function which we called PlayRPS, which picked a random number between 1 and 3 and then did different things depending on the number it picked. So for Rock, we remember we had a square of LEDs and we heard one musical note and so on. Now, we did tell you when you were creating your own game to try and keep it as basic as possible, because sometimes we have these amazingly brilliant ideas, which is so good, but until we have the coding fundamentals down, it might be hard to kind of come up with a really explicit game. So if I go down, I'm going to go through what we did. So I developed out, because really I've based it on something very familiar called 20 questions. So the game 20 questions, obviously, if you're not familiar, is someone thinks of something and then, so say for example, I might think of a famous person and then Niamh gets to ask me 20 questions to try and whittle it down to who that might be. And all I can say is yes or no. So she might say, are they Irish? And if I say no, then she knows, okay, I don't need to think about any more Irish famous people anymore, etc. Okay, but what I was thinking was, how about we get the microbit to pick a category so that if you're playing 20 questions, what you do first is you, what did I use my input here? Button A. So when we press button A on the microbit, what will happen is it will assign a category. So if, for example, if you look at my code here, and I've done it out, instead of doing it with you, I'm hoping you can follow now the code on my screen, but I will walk us through it. So my function is called 20 questions. My category, I've created a variable called category, which will pick a random number between 1 and 3. Very similar to rock, paper, scissors, except it was RPS last time, remember. So category will be equal to 1, 2, or 3. If the category is equal to 1, I'm going to see the string film. And if you notice this line, this might be, or these two lines, it might be new to you. And I'm going to give you, let you in on something here. I did not know that off by heart. I had to go back to blocks to find that. I wasn't sure how to start a melody with Python. So what I did was I hopped into a new program, I brought a melody block in, and I toggled, and I was like, ah, that's how we do it, right? So again, don't be feeling like you have to do everything. That's why the toggling is really useful. So I toggled back and I seen to play a melody instead of just one note like we did the last time. I could use these lines of code and I could change the melody name here. So dada, how do I say that? Da-da-da-dum is that one. But you'll see as I go down, here's another one, entertainer and ode. They're the three melodies I've used. So if the category is one, I saw film and I hear da-da-da-dum. Delighted I got that in one go. And then I can see what I've done is something else. So this is kind of a kind of little spin I put on this. I also said that the film word, so basically say the film had one word or two words. So one word might be Jaws, two words might be, I don't know, The Insider is coming to my head, I haven't a clue. So you get the idea. And it will also do that for me when I shake my microbit. So if it picks one, I'll see film. I'll hear da-da-da-dum. So if I can't see film, I'll hear the melody da-da-da-dum and I'll know, okay, it's a film. And then it will also show me either one or two, because it's going to pick randomly between one or two words. And if it's one word, I'll hear one musical note. And if it's two words, I'll hear two musical notes. So that's a bit of an extension within the extension, but I just wanted to show you how you could do some conditions within your other conditional statement, okay? Now, if it doesn't pick one, that's a lot for one. Okay, so hopefully you're okay up to here. If it doesn't pick one, it picks two, maybe. It's going to show us TV and I'm just hearing a melody. I haven't done the whole pick a random number between one and two and show me that or anything. Or else it'll pick a book and it'll play a different melody again. So how about we test it out now? I don't think we'll have time to play the game because that might be a while, like yes, no, yes, no, okay. Really good game though, don't need any equipment for it, okay. Great one to play in the car. Okay, and finally my input is on button press, button A will call on my function 20 questions. So that's how I'm gonna test it now, just to remember. I'm gonna come back in. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna keep testing my program till I've seen all three categories. So you shouldn't trust, if you just see one, you shouldn't be like, oh, it's working, because you can't actually really be sure until you've seen every single possible outcome. All right, so just to kind of point that out with your when you're testing your code. So I'm gonna come and press A. Okay, so TV. There's the song. So if I can't see TV, I'm gonna hear that melody and I'm gonna know, okay, I need to think of a TV show. And I haven't given any specific number range for that one, but just that's it. So TV is good, that's working. Let's check, hopefully we get. Okay, here's film. Okay, now I've spotted a slight issue here with this one. So it showed the string film, so that's fine. It started the melody. And you might have noticed, and it's actually still on the screen, there's a number one, because when I got the variable film word to pick a random number between one and two, it picked one. But when it picked one, it should have played a musical tone. Now, it actually did play the musical tone, but it interfered with the melody, so we didn't hear it very well. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to move this line of code up, because the sequence is probably interfering a bit. It's not wrong, it's just that the sequence is kind of too fast. So I'm gonna control an X to cut that line of code out. And I'm actually gonna say that the first thing that I want the micro to do if it picks one and for film is it plays the melody first, then shows the film string, then it's gonna pick a random number between one and two, show us which number it picked, and then do the associated musical notes so that if I can't see the number, I'll hear by the note, okay? So let's just check that again. Hopefully now this is gonna be, I'm gonna give you another little hack here actually, because we might be here all day testing. I'm just gonna come in here and I'm gonna change category to be equal to one, specifically just for this test, okay? So just to highlight, I'm deleting this picking a random number just for the moment, just my test, because now it's definitely gonna pick one for me, okay? So I'm gonna come back in here and press A. It's gonna pick one. There we go. Perfect. So now it's working. So that's the kind of the importance of the sequence thing. So it wasn't wrong, like I said, it wasn't wrong. It's just that it kind of wasn't as clear as I wanted.
Yeah.
Sometimes rejigging the sequence like that can be useful. We've noticed that even with blocks and Eve, sometimes we notice that it's just a little, cleans it up a little bit. Okay, now remember I changed him something here. I'm gonna just change that back. Or actually, will we just test maybe for book? So yeah, that's gonna be three. So just to test, for testing purposes, remember, this is not the correct code right now, but I'm gonna just change my category to be equal to three, so that when I call on the function, it's definitely gonna pick three. So it's definitely gonna do my else statement. So let's just check that. There we go. So it's definitely, we knew that because we made sure of it. And there's the music. Be here all day. Okay. Oh, we really will be here all day. Sorry, I'm gonna hit stop. Okay, so that is working, so I'm happy, but I just wanna make sure again that I go back and adjust my program the way it was, which was that I do want this to be random. So I'm gonna go back and make it a random integer between one and three, and now it would be completely random. So we could play the game 20 questions. We might have to think of a movie for the game. We might have to think of a TV show. We might have to think of a book. But hopefully you can see how it's accessible. It's something interesting, but it's also simple enough as well. So I am going to leave that screen up, and now will be a good time to pause, talk through the code with someone in your classroom, or even look through it if you're at home, and then we'll come back and pick up where we left off. Okay, so hopefully looking through that, it made it a bit similar. I knew I threw a bit of a curveball with the whole conditions within the conditions, but it's just, again, we're trying to show you the possibilities with this so that when you go off to build your own programs, which we'll talk about in episode 6, you're kind of aware of what you can do, okay? So with that being said, we're going to go on to today's challenge. As Niamh mentioned at the start, we are going to specifically look at something that encourages us to be active or healthy, which links to our Sustainable Development Goal 3. And as we said, that is one of two possible goals you can focus a project on if you wanted to enter the Do Your Bit competition, okay? So I'm going to go and make a new project, as always, at the start of our episodes. So I would like you to do the same. So if you go to makecode.microbit.org now, create your own new project and name it what you want. I'm going to call mine episode 5 and click create. As always, we're going to toggle straight into Python. We should be rolling our sleeves up at this stage and not be a bit worried about the fact that we're toggling over. It should be all natural. Hopefully you're actually like enjoying the Python now. I found at the start, once I started going to Python, I didn't really want to even go back. I got really hooked on it. Like, I find it really interesting to work through it. But that's me, and some people think I'm mad, so that's fine. Right, so let's delete this and start from the beginning. Okay, as always, we're going to add comments as we go. And Niamh, I might get you to go along and just keep an eye on my syntax and my code as I go too. Alert me, please, if you notice anything. And I'm going to comment, and I'm going to say that what we're going to do today is create a step counter. Now again, this is a kind of a familiar enough piece of code that's done with the visual programming, so you might have done this before. Potentially you just haven't done it within Python. So we're going to have a think about this. Now a step counter or a pedometer is something very familiar to us. They're embedded in our phones. Fitness watches is what you're usually used to, counting our steps as we walk throughout the day. Obviously, the microbit has the ability to pick up movements, which we've talked about before. So what we want to do maybe is that when the microbit moves a certain way, it counts that movement as a step. And we want the microbit to store that information, okay? So that's kind of the really important part. All right. Now, we are going to have to use something that we introduced last week in Python again, which are variables. And we're going to use them slightly differently this time. Okay, so I'm going to go down to my second line of code and I'm going to create my variable. And again, you can call it whatever you want. I'm going to call it steps. And remember, when we're assigning a value to a variable, we just use one equal sign. And realistically, if you think about a step counter, when the microbit starts, we don't want it to start on any number other than 0. Yeah. So when it turns on, it's on 0, and then we'll get it to count from there in a moment. But realistically, that's what we want it to do. So we're going to say steps equals 0, and that's good to go. Okay, the next thing we're going to do then is decide when do we want our steps to begin to count. So on this one, I suppose I'm thinking, Niamh, of going with a shake. However, what I would say to you is this could be one you might need to test out a bit. If you did, now you might not have the microbit, which is absolutely fine if you don't. But if you did, it could be worth seeing how forceful you have to be when you take a step. Because a shake with a microbit is literally just a slight movement. There's other forces you might notice in the inputs area, 3G, 6G and stuff. They're more kind of forceful shakes. So they could be used, but I'll go with a shake just because it's easier for us to test it, okay? So I'm going to do input dot, do what we've always done. Remember, that's a gesture. And automatically, remember, the default is to be a shake. And we are so familiar with this at this stage, I think, like it's brought in all this other code, which we are now going to adjust to suit ourselves. So the first thing I'm going to adjust is the name of my function. I'm going to define my function as, step counter, Niamh?
Step counter.
Okay, so step counter, and I have my brackets and my colon here, so that's good. So that we're used to that line for our definition of our function, or defining our function. Pass, I'm going to delete, because we're going to put our unit of code in there in a second. And just while we're at it, let's just check. This is obviously the line that calls in our function, so when we shake, we're going to call on the unit of code stored within here. We need to change this, because I've just changed the name of the function to step counter. And now we should be up to speed. Okay, right. So what I would like you to do now is actually pause and think about what exactly you want the microbit to do every time it shakes, and write that down for me. All right, so hopefully now when you think about this, you've jotted down a few sets of instructions. Again, just away from the computer for a second before we apply it in code. So what we want the microbit to do is when we shake the microbit once, it will count that as a step, and we will then see that number as a result as well. So we need it not only to count, but display the information to us. It's up to us when we want to display it, but we might just keep that in mind, all right? Because with something like a variable, think about like a computer, there's lots of stuff happening in the background. We're not seeing everything. It's just doing it for us. That will be the same with this until we say display, okay? Or show us this. So within our function here, the first thing we're going to have to do is identify that we are going to be working with the variable we created here, which is called steps. Okay, and because we're going to be using that variable within this function, it's called a global variable. So the first thing we need to write is global, followed by the name of our variable. Now remember, you could have named it differently, so don't be following me exactly. You could have called it step or counter, whatever. Mine is step, so I need to write that. And that's the first instruction we have in there now. Okay, now I also want to see, before we think about even counting my steps, I want to make sure that I see the number here on my screen when the microbit starts. And right now, that is not happening for me, okay? I'm not seeing the number of steps here. So remember, that's because with a variable, it's happening in the background. So I actually might come up here and actually say basic.show_number. Brackets, and we've used this before and we've put numbers in and we've done operations and different things like that, but the number I want to see is whatever the number of steps it is. So I'm going to actually just write steps in there, believe it or not, and it will know then to pull on my variable and the value that it's stored here. Okay, so let's just test that now. So now I'm seeing the number. So initially it was just my variable, so until I say I want to see that variable, nothing's going to happen, so I'm happy with that. Okay. So with our step counter, when we shake the microbit and it calls on our function for our step counter, it's going to know first of all that it's working with our number of steps, okay, or our variable steps here. And the next thing I want it to do when it shakes is to add the number one. So on each shake, we have a plus one. Okay, so this is where using our variables, we haven't done this before, this is new, so stay with me on this one. We're going to say steps is now going to be equal to steps plus one, okay? Or you could write it like this, so it's up to you. So that's one way. Or the quick way that people use is we say steps plus equals one, okay? And that means the same thing. So what that means is steps, remember, is automatically at zero at the start, okay? And then in our step counter, when we shake and we use this function, whatever steps is, we're going to add one, all right? And remember with a variable, it can update. So just because it was at zero here, the whole thing with variables is it stores it, but it can update it too. So it will update. So when we shake it once, it will go to one. Shake it again, it will go to two. And it will keep adding it on and on and on. Hopefully we're good on that. Now remember, this is going to happen, but if I test it, look here, so I'm going to shake. I'm not seeing anything. Now, that doesn't mean it's not working. Remember, this is happening in the background. I need to tell it to show me this. So I'm going to go down a line, and I'm going to use my instruction to say basic.showMeTheNumber. Oh, spelling it wrong. Number of. And again, in my brackets, I'm not putting a number. I'm saying just use my variable that I've already assigned a value to. Okay. Okay, so we want to test this again. So we're going to shake, and it says one. And remember, it's going to store that number. And then when I shake again, which it did automatically when I moved there, when I shake again, it will call on that function again and add another one. So if I go shake, it adds one again, and it will continue to do that over and over again. So there's a kind of basic enough step counter done. So now would be a good time to pause, get your microbit working alongside a step counter, but bear in mind how we can keep this inclusive as well. Okay, so hopefully we all have our step counter working. I'd love to know how you got on with kind of adding that accessibility or inclusive feature to it. We were having a discussion there. We were saying that we could add, similar to last time, every time there's a shake, we could hear a musical note.
Yeah.
But if you think about it, that could get annoying for someone. Do you know, it'd be like beep, beep. I'd say now after 1 minute of walking, you'd want to throw the thing away. So from a design point of view, that might not work very well. So something else you could do, I haven't done it here, but I'm just going to say it, and I'd love to know if someone wants to take this challenge on. Something else you could do is maybe on another input, okay, you could look at the number of steps, and if the steps was equal to 5, 10, 15, 20, it makes a certain noise, so that it's actually, you're taking numbers together as opposed to getting one individual step as one individual note. All right, but there would be quite a bit of code in that, but absolutely take on the challenge if you can. That would be great, and let us know how you get on. But it's just, again, we're just trying to highlight that, you know, this might not work for everyone. So just kind of have that inclusivity in their heads, okay? Right, so Niamh, what I was thinking was, right, this is going to count our number of steps. But I used to be a PE teacher, and so I used to try and encourage everyone to take as many steps as possible, as we all know. So even in here, I'm always looking at how many steps I've done. And so what I was thinking was we could now program, now that we've looked at variables, we could kind of go back over them again in another way. And we could create maybe a timer. And so then the challenge could be, like, how many steps can you get done in this time? Like a countdown timer, basically.
Sounds good.
Yeah. And so what I'm thinking is, with the timer, the nice thing about this is it allows us to introduce the other loop type that we haven't discussed yet.
Yes.
So you know we've done the for loop.
For loop, so while loops.
Exactly, we haven't done while loops. So it's a nice way for us to look at that. And again, it gives you more a breadth of stuff that you understand, again, if you want to create a program to enter the competition with in Python. Okay, so I'm going to come down a line and I'm going to say create a countdown timer is what we're doing here. Oh, that's the only thing about it automatically doing stuff for you. It kind of annoys me sometimes that way. Put a space first. There we go. Okay, so with our countdown timer, first of all, we need to think about how much time we want this to count down for. So, Niamh, I completely over to you on this one. Let me know how many seconds. We'll say seconds.
Maybe 60 seconds.
60 seconds. Okay. So that means the first thing we're going to do is create a variable and assign the value of the time we want the countdown to start at, which will be 60 in this case. So I'm going to create, we'll call it time, sure. Very original. And equals, the value we are going to assign to time is 60. Now you can, again, put your own spin on this and you can say 30, 20, 10, whatever you want. Okay, but we're going to say 60 seconds. Okay, we're then going to come down a line and we are going to say create our function. So how about we do this kind of from scratch instead of, again, you know, just again to show alternative ways of doing functions. So remember at this stage, Niamh, what's the first thing we're going to do? We're going to define.
We're going to define our function.
So def. Okay. So Niamh, what do you think we'll call, what we call our function or define our function as?
Maybe countdown.
Countdown. Okay, perfect. Not the show. Okay,
no.
Not the TV show. Okay, so countdown, and again, remember, brackets for our function, colon, and we're good to go. Now we can create our unit of code. Right, so before we keep going, now would be a good time to pause, similar to what we did with the step counter, and write down the steps you think are going to be needed to get this to count down from 60 to 0. Okay, so hopefully you have a couple of steps written down for how you want this countdown timer to work. We've been chatting about it here as well. So we know that maybe it, first of all, on a certain input, we see 60, because that's what we've decided it starts on. And then after every second,
it might decrease by one.
It decreases by one, exactly. And now you could do like every 2 seconds, it decreases by two, but you just have to use your maths there to kind of calculate. But yeah, we'll go every second. We take away one from the variable time, which is 60, so it should come down one and so on. And it continues to do that, okay? So let's come up here and decide what we want to do next. Well, first of all, remember similarly to the above, we had steps equals zero, but then when we were using that variable within a function, we needed to identify it and call it a global variable. So we're going to type in global, and just make sure that you use the right variable name. For me, remember, it is time, and we are good on that. Okay, so that's just letting basically our, that's just letting our function know where that variable has come from, all right? Down a line. Now here comes our first introduction to while loops. So we talked about loops before. We talked about for loops, which were a specific kind of number. So we were like, for, remember we said for I in range, and we had a number, and it did it for that amount of times. Now with a while loop, it will continue to execute until the situation is no longer relevant anymore. It's not the same, okay? So the clever way of doing this one, I suppose, would be to think about when do we no longer want this timer to count down?
Well, when it reaches zero.
Exactly, when it reaches zero, okay? So what we wanna say here is while, okay? And you can see it goes blue because that's a keyword. While time is greater than zero. So basically the code now within this loop will only run once time, our variable, is a bigger number than zero. And once it gets to zero, it's gonna cut the loop. It's done, okay? It knows to stop at that point, okay? So it's gonna keep going, keep repeating. We don't need to say repeat this 60 times or whatever. It's gonna keep repeating until it gets to zero, and then it should, if we are all going well, it should stop, or until it gets to one, actually, really. Okay, so I'm gonna do while time is greater than zero, I'm gonna do a colon because this is a loop. So remember, you should see an indent now because we're containing code within a loop. So while time is greater than zero, I'm gonna come down. And the first thing I think we should really see is the number.
Yeah.
So we should see like the first number. Okay, so basic dot show underscore number, open bracket. And again, we're not given a specific number here. We're referring back to our variable, which is time. In my case, yours might be different. So we're going time. Okay. All right, Nat?
Looks good.
The next thing we're doing, so let's just think about this for a second. It's going to be 60. And then what we said was we wanted to pause for a period of time and then decrease by one. So that's the order of our code. So if we mix up a sequence here, it could mess up the whole thing. So just be careful about that. So the next thing is a pause. So pause, if you remember, Niamh used these in the episode one. They were from the basic menu. So if we say basic.pause, you can see it comes in here. And remember, it comes in milliseconds. So 100 is a tenth of a second. So we need 1,000 for it to be one whole second. So 1,000 is one whole second. So we're gonna see when the time is greater than zero. So that's gonna definitely apply when it's 60. We'd see 60 and it will hold for 1 second. And then the next thing we wanted to do is take away one, okay? So similarly to up here, except up here we added a number, we're gonna be taking away, but it's the same idea. We're gonna say time, two ways of doing it, time equals time minus one, or the quick way, which is time, we do a subtraction sign, a minus sign,
equals one.
Okay? And now that should tell us to say, take away one. What's going to happen is, because this is a while loop, think about what loop means. So when time is greater than zero, so 60 is going to run. So 60 is going to come in here first. It's going to come to the next line of code. It's going to see, is this true for me? Is it greater than zero? Yes. It's then going to execute all this, 60, take 1 second, take away one. That's going to bring us to 59. So when it loops back up to the top here, it's still greater than zero. It will execute again, loop, execute again, until it's not greater than zero anymore. Hopefully that makes sense up to that point. Okay, so I think this should work, but I wouldn't mind just giving it a test. The only thing is, all I've done so far is define my function with a unit of and create a unit of code, but I haven't called on it or have no way of calling on it yet. So we need to come up with an input. I think I'll use a button. So I think we'll go input dot on underscore button. I'm just going to write this out. Pressed, open my brackets, and I'll go with, have I used a button yet? No, so I can use any button. So I'll go with button dot A, and I'm going to do a comma, and now I'm going to write my function name, which was countdown in here. Countdown. Okay. And hopefully that should work. Why is it saying there's a problem? Oh, no, it's not. It's gone. Phew. Okay, so let's test this out. So when I press A, I should call on my function countdown, and we should see this happen. Okay.
And just for our test, Amanda, we might change the time to 10 so that it's quicker.
Grant, good shout, actually. Yeah, okay, so I'm going to change that to 10. So we should see 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, all going well, except we won't say Happy New Year at the end. And let's come up here and hit A. Here we go, 10. 1 second. 9. 1 second, hopefully. There we go. Okay.
Great.
So we can see it's working down. Now, one thing I did mention I was thinking we might add, because if we look here, I think it's going to stop at 1. So what I would actually like is it to also do something when it gets to 0. So right now, it's only going to execute code when it's greater than 0. So what I might do is add a little condition here to say that if time is equal to 0, then we see like a string that says time up or something like that.
Sounds good.
So I'm going to come back inside my function and I'm going to hop out here. It's not within my while loop. Remember, this is all that's happening for my while loop. So when I come down, I'm still within my while loop. Just be careful. Come back out of that to do our condition. So I'm going to say if time, and remember two equal signs, 0, colon, and down. I'm going to say basic dot show string time up. Or you could do like an icon or something, whatever you would like, but I'm just going to go with that. And so now let's test that again. So this time, and we'll just speed us up, we'll change it to 5 this time. So we'll go 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So we're refreshing. We're going to press our button A to call in our function. And yay. Okay, time's up at 0. Great. All right, I am going to go full screen on that. And now will be a good time to pause and allow yourselves to get up to speed with this. But again, think about how we could make this maybe slightly more inclusive. Okay, so hopefully you got on okay there doing that with the countdown timer. Now, similar to the other ones, I was thinking of adding music, but again, instead of every second being a note, because that would be extremely annoying, I was thinking just have a sound when the timer begins and then a sound when it's over, okay? So what I've done here is, because I've said my time starts at 5, I've said that within my while loop, if the time is equal to 5, so only if it's 5, which should be the start of the timer in this case, I'll hear this musical note once. And then down here when I did my condition for time equals 0, I've now added 2 notes to signal the time is up, but then we'll see time up as well. So real quick, we'll just test that out. So I'm going to hit A. I should hear 1 note because it starts at 5 and then it counts down. And at 0, I should hear 2 and see time up. Here we go. Here we are. 5, 4, 3, 2, feels very slow, 1. Okay, so it is working, so I'm happy with that. Now, the reason we're looking at these things, remember, is because we're thinking about how it can encourage us to be healthy. So how many steps could we get done within those seconds that we've assigned ourselves? And health is another big focus area for us and how we can use technology to help. So Niamh, we might look at AI for health, which is something we said we'd cover today.
Exactly, and that's one of our AI for good pillars here in Microsoft. So before we do that, let's take a look at some of the possibilities for AI for health.
It's the symbiotic relationship between the human and machine that brings the magic of AI to medicine in a meaningful way.
Now we have the tools to make a huge difference to human life.
Cancer research is increasingly powered by data. Those data remain siloed across institutions.
We're creating a data ecosystem that allows people to share data and making sure that we're doing that in a way that still maintains the privacy of the patients.
With the power of AI, we can go after the unknown. And I can guarantee that we'll find something that nobody expected.
Sudden infant death syndrome scares every mother and father, and it is a problem. We have to change. The collaboration with Microsoft, AI for Health, will help to start this next step of our discovery. Our data show very convincingly clear correlation between smoking and SIDS, and just changing behavior can save children's lives. You cannot measure the benefit of that.
It's a sad day when the patient comes in and I can't impact them.
Through AI for Health, we will be building an AI solution that can autonomously diagnose diabetic retinopathy.
With the portable camera, I can take healthcare to the patients who would not be able to come to us.
I want you to look right here.
Going forward, we can address the 500 million patients that are out there and disrupt this disease. AI for Health and Iris together can have that impact.
Today, there are 200,000 leprosy patients diagnosed every year. If you catch it in the stage of a skin lesion, you can cure the person. We are teaching an AI algorithm to recognize leprosy in an image of a skin lesion.
With AI, we can help patients help themselves to get to the right experts at the right time. If you can help a child to not lose their fingers, that means everything.
Innovation comes from bringing different perspectives together. And what an amazing partnership this is for all of us.
When you see that you can make a big impact on somebody's life, that's the greatest thing ever.
We can help eliminate the oldest disease known to man and make history. That's how we want to contribute to the world.
One example in that video that really struck a chord with me was Iris. And Iris stands for Intelligent Retinal Imaging Systems. And I suppose why that really stood out to me was because one of my friends actually has diabetes. And one thing that diabetes can affect is a person's vision. So it's really important that people with diabetes get their annual eye test, because 95% of diabetic retinopathy is actually preventable.
Right.
So therefore, it's really important that it's accessible to get those tests. And it actually stated that only 35% of people with diabetes actually get their annual test.
Right. And so obviously, Niamh, the AI system works in such a way that it's obviously trained on images of what the eye should look like at certain stages, or
exactly,
a healthy eye, or when you need more support or help, or maybe medication and stuff like that.
So it's picked up to pick out detailed pathology that's not always easy for the human eye to pick out.
Okay.
And they're bringing that to communities where people aren't able to actually access maybe centres.
Opticians and stuff.
Exactly.
Yeah. Because I think I've seen in the video, like, they're able to use their phone. It looks like very basic equipment. But
exactly.
Again, because the AI technology is behind it, it's able to do really advanced stuff with basic enough equipment.
Exactly.
So it shows how powerful that can be, I suppose. Brilliant. So that's great. So that's just another cool example of how it can all work, how technology can help and benefit. And again, if we think about our global goals, it's all relatable to that. And it's giving people access maybe they don't have in the instance of Iris.
So now we look at what we covered in today's episode. So in today's episode, the first thing we looked at was our extension challenge from the previous episode. And then we moved on and programmed our microbit to help encourage us to get our steps up.
Yeah, and use our timer as well.
Exactly, and we incorporated our timer. And finally, we discussed AI for health with our iris
example,
exactly.
Yeah, definitely. So lots covered again. Now, we haven't forgotten there is going to be an extension challenge. And this one, it might be a little bit tricky, so I don't want you to give up on it or be deflated if you're finding this hard, because personally, I've completed the challenge and I know it took me a couple of times or a couple of chances to get this to work. So what we want you to do for your extension challenge is combine the two functions that we've made in some way. So remember, we created a function for counting our steps and we created a function for counting down a certain amount of time. What I would love is that if you hit one input, for example, you hit button A, it not only begins to count down time, but it also begins to count your steps. So we're combining those two together within one function and on one input. There will be a little tricks and challenges involved. You might have to bring in some conditional statements. You need to be very careful about the sequence and order of your code, but give it a shot. If you can't get it to work, don't worry. We'll go through the solution in the next episode. So join us then. Chat to you. Bye.
Bye.